This podcast is brought to you by Custom Plan Financial Advisors, Inc., an independent insurance managing general agency in Canada. Financialpodcast.ca was developed with one goal in mind, to educate Canadians on important topics that affect their financial well-being and make it readily available to all. We welcome you to plug in and learn with us. If you have questions, please email us at contact@financialpodcast.ca.
Good day, everyone, and welcome to Financial Podcast. My name is Darlene, and I'm your host. Many of you out there may have clients that want to do some, if not all, of their own investing. Some will be successful at it, and some won't be. Today, we're talking to Vitaly Katsanelson, that's a bit of a mouthful for me, who is the CEO and Chief Investment Officer of IMA, an individual portfolio managers in the USA. Vitaly has written many interesting articles for The Contrarian Edge that deal with many different aspects of the investor life. Thank you, Vitaly, for coming on our program today.
Oh, Darlene, it's my pleasure. Thank you.
So my introduction of you was pretty brief, but you have many accomplishments in this field. Would you like to tell our listeners a little bit more about yourself?
Well, I don't want to brag. No, listen, I'm a kind of a diehard value investor. I run IMA, which is a basically a value investment firm in Denver, Colorado. And we just basically, what we try to do, we have high net worth individuals, people, doctors, lawyers, engineers come to us and say, here's my life savings, please don't screw it up. And so that's, and we invest money for them. And I like to write because this is how I think. I mean, if I spend about 1 or 2 hours a day writing, and I get up in the morning, first thing every morning, I write for about 1 or 2 hours, and that helps me think. So some of this writing spills into my articles, which your listeners can find on contrarianedge.com, or they can listen to them, being read to them on investor.fm. Some of them will spill into my books. And I've written 2 books, working on the third one. And that's kind of, that's my life story. I have a slight accent from Louisiana. No, but I know.
Obviously.
No, I was born in Russia, and I moved to the United States about 30 years ago.
And you do a podcast. Do you do a podcast in Russian as well, or do translations of your podcasts?
No. So the podcast is a kind of very different podcast from anything out there, because I'm too lazy to do podcasts. So what we do, my articles are read to listeners by a professional narrator. That's all it is. That's just my articles kind of read to you. And we found that people love it, because some people don't have time to read, and some people want to listen to podcasts while they're working out or driving to work. So that's why we did it. And the best part, I have absolutely nothing to do with that. In other words, it's just been produced by somebody else at IMA, and it just happens. So that's the best type of podcast.
You just give them the content.
Yes, I just provide the content, and then it just gets done. Yeah, and about my Russian. So I left Russia 30 years ago. I was almost 30 years ago. I was 18 years old. And all my education in Russia was basically kind of a technical education. I went to college for a few years, but it was a very technical education. So my business Russian is not very good. And let me tell you how bad it is. So my first book, Active Value Investing, was translated in 7 languages, from Chinese to Korean to German, and others. Okay. But it was never translated into Russian. And I really wanted the book to be translated into Russian because I wanted my father to read it. My father came to the United States when he was 58, and he tried incredibly hard to study English, but it's very difficult to study a new language when you are, pushing 60 years old. So his English never got great. So I really wanted my father to read it. So I contacted a Russian publisher, which is not something you usually do. So usually when you publish a book, your publisher goes and reaches out and signs all these contracts, and you open your door one day and you find there's a book in some kind of Asian language you don't understand, sitting on your door. And that's how you find out that your book has been translated. In this case, I actually reached out to a Russian publisher and I said, here's my book, would you like to publish it? And it was like one of the most biggest publishers in Russia, Alpina, I think, I forget the name of it. And they said, sure, but would you mind editing the book? So in other words, they would translate the book, send it to me, and I would read it basically and kind of comment on that. So anyway, I did this and I forgot about it. But maybe 6 months later, I get this email that has a whole bunch of Word documents, which is basically my book translated. I open them and start reading the book. And I realized I have no idea what it says. It's like so I understand every single word, but when you these words come together, the sentences have very little meaning to me. So to shorten the story, I basically asked my father to edit that book for me. And actually, it was a great bonus because it ended up being a great father-son experience. And here's the interesting thing. So when I got into investing, my father always thought that I'm kind of like a almost like a professional gambler. And he always thought that, you know, like at some point I need to get a real job. And his ideas were like, hey, how about this? Why don't we open a donut shop or a bagel store? Or like, I'm like, Dad, I have an undergraduate graduate degree in finance. I have a CFA. He's like, yeah, but that stuff is gambling and stuff. Anyway, so the point is this. After my father read my Russian book, like they translated into, yeah, my investment book translated into Russian, he actually understood that it's not quite science and it's not quite art and somewhere in between, but what I'm doing is real. Like, so I don't have to, this is when he stopped telling me that I should get a, you know, that we should go into donut business. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, a real job. Anyway. So that's a very long-winded answer to your question, but yes.
Well, you know what? It's fascinating, though. Yeah, you know, there's always a backstory to everybody, and I always enjoy hearing people's stories about who they are and where they got to where they are, because that leads in to what we're talking about today. And you wrote a great article with investor tips. You had three great investor tips. And the first tip was, don't constantly check your portfolio. Can you tell us why? Why would you not want to do that?
Okay, that's a very important. The stocks are priced every single day by enthusiastic or not so enthusiastic buyers and sellers, but they're not valued every day. So if you look at your portfolio on a daily basis, what you're really seeing is a lot of kind of noise. And if you had two brains, okay, if it was one brain that could get the information and kind of compartmentalize it into like kind of, oh, this is noise, I don't care. And then another one is like, oh, this is information, I'm going to process it. If you had two brains, then it would have been fine. The only problem is you have one brain. And every day when you're seeing the stocks up or down, you actually, what it does, it shrinks your time horizon. When you buy a stock, if you are a thoughtful investor, you're really buying a business, right? You're buying a business that happens to be publicly traded and happens to be quoted every day. But just like if, let's say, you wanted to open a donut shop, right? Like, you know, and it's, you know, it was a private donut shop, etc. Like, you would not see a price of this donut shop every single day, right? Even though if that donut shop was publicly traded, I'm sure there would be, based on the weather, traffic patterns, and a whole bunch of other noise, a price for the donut shop every single day. And it would drive you crazy. So if you are looking at your portfolio, what it does, it shrinks your time horizon. And you stop being an investor and you become, and it tends to gravitate you from being an investor into a trader, okay? And or a gambler, or even worse, a gambler, okay? And so I would argue that one of the first things we ask our clients is to not look at their portfolio, okay? They can, you know, they can see every transaction when it happens because, you know, they have access to the portfolio through this discount brokerage firm. But we ask them not to look at it on a daily basis, maybe quarterly, even less than that, if it's possible. And I tell you this, I've been doing this for a long, long time. I can tell if the relationship with the client is going to be successful or not by this little signs. If they look at their portfolio on a daily basis, it's at the end of the day, it's going to drive them insane. And it's going to just, that relationship is not going to work out.
Yeah. You know what, honestly, I think that probably applies to a lot of things, because if you do a constant monitoring of, you know, all sorts of different things, you're not going to see the forest for the trees, really. It's kind of what it comes down to. But one of the One of the challenges, though, with today is that with today's technology, people have access to all of those numbers on a daily basis. And it would be tough for somebody to pass that up. How do you persuade them that to not access that technology?
Well, so I think, first of all, I explained them that it has zero value. It's going to add zero value. And what they're seeing is just complete random fluctuations. That's number one. Number two, I tell them that the reason they hired me is so they don't have to look at their portfolio.
Master.
Okay. So, but one thing I do, and which is I think very, like some people do this, but a lot of them don't. About four times a year, I write this incredibly in-depth letters to clients. And let's say we bought Microsoft. I'm just making this up. And I say, we bought Microsoft, and here's why. And there is a very in-depth analysis of how we're looking at Microsoft. And when you read this analysis, you realize I'm buying a business. I'm not buying a stock that's trading, you know, it trades at $222.55. I'm buying a business that I tend to hold for a long, long time. So what the market thinks about the stock to price tomorrow is irrelevant, or today. And then we sell a business. I say, we sell a stock. I say, we sold the stock. Here's why. And then I go through almost every position in the portfolio and kind of provide them updated thoughts on those businesses. And I think this is probably one of the most important things I do for clients, because my goal is to provide good returns for clients for volatility of their blood pressure. Okay, so I have zero control over how volatile my stocks are going to be, but I have a lot of control through communications to clients of what, to a large degree, what the volatility of their blood pressure is going to be.
I like how you worded that. And I think that's an important distinction to make, is that if you're already giving them a great deal of information, that's not something then that they need to constantly monitor. Because you're right, they're buying the business. They're not necessarily just like, otherwise it's gambling.
Yes.
So your next tip, I really like it. It's ignore the media messengers. So for a lot of people who watch the business news, the media are looked upon as experts in their field. So why would you want people to ignore the media messengers?
Well, there are so many reasons for that. Number one, the business networks are really not business networks. They're really entertainment shows, right? They're in the business of entertainment, because if they were boring business shows, you would not be watching them, because we need to be entertained. So they provide entertainment, and that's something, it's very important to know that, but that's number one. So the amount of value you add out of this is probably, that helps your portfolio, probably very little, number one. Number two, the time horizon of a talking head on a TV and your time horizon may be very different. And a lot of time, the time horizon of these people is very, very short. Therefore, what happens, your time horizon that should be long-term should be protected at any cost. Like we talked about, not looking at your portfolio. Same thing, you try to protect it by not listening to, not watching business TV, because the time horizon of these people is very short-term and it's going to shrink yours as well. And by the way, does it really matter what the Federal Reserve is going to do tomorrow? Like, does it really matter what the job number is in the loan context? Probably not. It's like almost like trying to, it's almost like, imagine if you spend all your time on analyzing what the weather is going to be tomorrow, okay? Even though you are not planning to travel for a long time. You're locked in the COVID, you have a COVID lockdown, and you can't go anywhere. So the business networks, they're focusing on the weather, where you should be, from a portfolio perspective, should be focusing on the climate. I say this, at the same time, I watch like thoughtful interviews with company CEOs or economists that I find, you know, that could help me to give me some insights. It doesn't mean that I'm completely ignoring what's going on around me, but I'm much more thoughtful and much more defensive about that.
Okay. So there are a couple that you do watch and read. So how do you do research on a company if you're looking at buying stocks for them? Where do you turn?
Oh, okay. Well, it's going to depend on the company. But like, I'm going to look at a company right now. I went on YouTube. And I watched probably almost every interview its CEO ever gave.
Okay.
Okay. I'm be subscribed to a service that allows me to look at the interviews of people who either work for the company before, or its suppliers, or its customers. So then I'm going to go and read the transcripts of the conference calls going back probably a few years. I'm going to read their S1, which is the form they have to file when they want to go public. It gives you a lot of information. I'm going to read their annual reports. Then we're going to build financial models. And then if you have questions, I'll probably call up the company. We'll talk to the company. I have a great network of other investors like me globally. I would talk to them and get their feedback, on that industry, etc. So that's kind of the process I'm going to go through. And I'll go on Spotify and do a podcast search and see if anybody has mentioned this company in one of the podcasts. And so that's our process.
Well, that's pretty thorough. You're looking at a lot of different avenues and taking a lot of different things into consideration beyond the stock price.
Yes, that's right. Just think about this for a second, right? I've done all this work and we bought this business, right? Does it really make sense for me to look at the stock price 3 times a day? Oh, this company that I think, let's say I'm buying at 25 and I think it's worth 100. Does it really make a difference if it goes to 22 first or it goes to 27 first? Like it makes, I'm planning to own it for a long, long time. And so what difference does it make? Like the only reason I would care if I bought at 25 goes to 15 or 20, because I may want to buy more, but that's about it, right? But the price itself kind of irrelevant. The opinion, what the market thinks about my company today is kind of, it's really not important.
Yeah. And, that kind of nicely rolls us into your third tip, be an investor, not a trader, which you talked about before.
No, I think that's right. I mean, we probably summed up this point already, right? But yeah, you want to be an investor, not a trader, because as an investor, I don't think I've seen a single successful trader. There's a old pilots and there's the bold pilots, but there are no old. Well, I think same thing applies to traders, right? I don't know a single trader who's been successful in the long run. There are a couple of people I know that have been extremely successful and then they blew up. And blowing up means you make a lot of money for a long time and then you just lose it all. If at the end of the day, you lose all the money, that previous success is probably worthless. We have this analytical framework I call the 6 commandments of value investing. And that basically, I took value investing philosophy and kind of wrote it in this kind of white paper. And if your listeners want to read this, it's absolutely free. There's nothing, no strings attached. They can go to 6commandments.com and they can download it there. Just absolutely free.
Yeah, that's great. Well, you know what? I've been through your website and you've got a ton of information out there for people. It's certainly useful. But when I was reading your article about investor tips and I came across tip number 3, you had a great question in there. You pose a great question in this article about whether quarterly earnings beat or miss expectations. You ask the question, how does this impact the value of the question? And so to me, that's a great question. It's a great thought-provoking question. And how would an investor determine this?
I guess my point would be it's almost irrelevant. I'll give you a couple. I wrote this article a while back comparing Jack Welch, who ran General Electric, to Jeff Bezos. And Jack Welch, and this is just if you read his books, who ran General Electric for 20 or 30 years, and he went into history as like one of the best CEOs, etc. But the problem is, after he left, General Electric kind of blew up. And he had this, I was reading his book, and this is probably like late 90s, early 2000s. And I remember where he talked about how he was so proud that General Electric always beat their earnings guidance, okay? And he talked about how he would go to CEO of one of the divisions and say, I need a few pennies of earnings, And the CEO says, no problem. And he would, just imagine what I just said. And he would give this, they were playing accounting tricks because it's, accounting tricks with, GE accounting. But here's the point I want to make, though. When you run a business for the long run, you have to make decisions that a lot of times will be detrimental to your short-term performance and therefore may actually detract from your earnings growth in the short term. And this is where Jeff Bezos comes in. Jeff Bezos talks about how when somebody congratulates him on the quarter, he said, you know, the thoughts that go from his head in his head are, well, this quarter is really a byproduct of the actions we made 3 years ago. It has absolutely nothing to do with what we did this quarter, you know, over the last 90 days. We planted the seeds for today's performance like years ago. And I can tell you personally, like I run IMA, right? It's a business. And I can tell you that from our business perspective, we are seeing like our business is performance today is impacted by the actions or by collection of little actions we made last year, 2 years ago, 3 years, even 4 years ago, right? So we don't have a, like, you know, it's a private business habit. So we don't have a, you know, we're not providing guidance, etc. We're not providing guidance or trying to beat our own estimates, whatever. It's irrelevant to us. And I'll tell you this, when you run a business in general, the business does not tick, like, and I can tell you just by looking at a small company I'm running here, our business, we're going to have good quarters and great quarters. And in the short term, they're completely, completely random. And so when I'm looking at companies, what I'm trying to listen to, if the CEOs spend a lot of time talking about beating the quarter, these companies probably are less interesting to me. If CEOs are talking about investment for the long term, these companies become a lot more interesting to me.
That's interesting, because a lot of people would have a really different perspective on Jack Welch, but you make a good point. I mean, you hear nothing about GE after he left.
GE imploded. You know, GE as a company has imploded after, imploded after he left.
Yeah. Whereas Amazon is doing phenomenally. I mean, there are definitely valid points. And my next question, it's not a part of your article, but because you have so much knowledge and have done so much research on different things, and I don't know if you're comfortable answering this question, but 2020 was a tough year and a different year than many companies had ever seen before. So when you're looking back, 2 years from now and companies that still managed to get through all of this. And again, things are different in the US than they are in Canada. But what are some of the highlights? Like what would be some of the positive points that you'd be looking for companies that did get through 2020 successfully?
That is a very good question and a very difficult question, because like one thing I start to appreciate is inefficiency of companies' balance sheet. And let me explain what I mean by this. Like for a long, long time, management tried to make the balance sheet as efficient as possible to maximize return on capital, right?
Yeah.
But, and then something like pandemic comes and they realize, while we had a lot fewer reserves than we should have had if this kind of once in a lifetime event happens, right? And suddenly we have to go out and issue a lot of shares and destroy our shareholders. Okay, so I also learned that like there's a lot of things kind of interesting. So our portfolios were positioned for a recession, meaning we owned very few cyclical businesses and companies that had good balance sheets and whose revenues are basically not dependent on the health of the economy. And we still found out that these companies were impacted by pandemic. Because I'll give an example: we own a company that makes submarines, right? You would argue that this business has absolutely no ties to the economy. Like, you know, they'll be making and servicing submarines for a long, long time. And the money has been earmarked for the submarines by the government long time ago, right? Except what we found that business was actually impacted by a pandemic, because it's very difficult to build a submarine while you're doing social distancing.
It's true. And you can't do it from home either.
Yeah, exactly. You know, you can do a lot of things for Microsoft from the comfort of this is an example, like what should I learn about this business? Oh, absolutely nothing. Like this was a freak thing. Has it impacted their value in the long term? Probably not. And, but I also, So that's one side of this. On the other side of it, we really haven't seen the consequences. If the company, if a lot of companies who were over-leveraged going into this, they survived just fine because the government basically just flooded market, bond market with, you know, Federal Reserve, you know, bought everything it could see inside. So that's really hasn't really, on the other side, we haven't really seen many consequences. There were a lot of zombie companies that were, that been in zombies before pandemic, they're still zombies. So I'm not sure if there is anything to learn from that. I think what we're also going to learn, and this is a long-term, I think, impact, we're going to become a lot, we're going to have a more balanced globalization where, like in the news from Intel yesterday, that it will be building a factory in Arizona. That's a huge news for the United States because the United States realized we can't really rely on the kindness of strangers and the kindness of China and China not invading Taiwan at anything, you know, and taking over Taiwan Semiconductor, and suddenly we have no semiconductors, you know, coming to the United States. So now you see Intel, Taiwan Semiconductor, Samsung are announcing they're going to they'll be building factories in the United States, which is, I think that's very good for us long term. I think and you know, obviously Canada as well, but that's kind of another. You know, I think our supply chains will be kind of will go through reevaluation of them.
Well, I think that's a good point that a lot of companies are probably going to be looking at their supply chains and wondering what adjustments can be made for greater efficiency so that, you know, you can leverage all sorts of different storms because you don't know really what the next storm out there is.
Yeah. And also, like, long term, it's going to be, and it's I'm still struggling to formulate these thoughts perfectly, but I think long term working from home, like the way we work is going to change somewhat. It's going to become more acceptable to work from home. Sometimes I think we're still going to come back to offices, but it's probably going to be hybrid offices. And the reason we come back to offices is because we realize we can tolerate our spouses the marriage benefits from both spouses missing each other throughout the day. You know, so I think but also at the same time, and this I'm thinking about my kids. You know, and you guys have the same thing. We have a snow day, and you know it means kids are sitting at home doing nothing. Now, when you have a snow day, they just log into their school's website and, you know, to whatever Zoom and do their Zoom call. They do a class on Zoom. That's which is I think good, you know, good for them.
Snow days like we knew them may be a thing of the past.
That's right. Another thing I was thinking about is that I think companies had an opportunity to take out a lot of fat they accumulated. So what happens usually is this: when economy is growing for long term, companies accumulate fat because when you're making a lot of money, you little by little you lose focus on your expenses, and you have inefficiencies kind of creep up over time. And when you go into recession, this is when the layoffs happen, and you start reexamining all your expenses. And I think, like, last year was a great opportunity for a lot of companies to look at their expense structure and say, well, maybe these costs are, you know, maybe we don't need to spend money on this. Maybe we have too many people, etc. And there is also one little psychological caveat. It's very difficult to fire people when things are going well. Last year, companies, corporations were given an excuse to right-size their sales force, their workforce. Like, I'll give an example. We own Uber. Uber laid off one quarter of their workforce last year. And that's going to save them $1 billion going forward. Okay. A lot of companies like Dropbox, who is still doing fine, laid off 10% of their employees last year. So that means that when things normalize for Uber and things come back to pre-pandemic level, the earnings power is going to be so much greater, right?
Yeah, they'll be a little bit more efficient.
Exactly. So, I mean, again, I'm using Uber as an example, but that applies across corporate America.
One of the things that we talked about in an earlier episode was how technology has changed and how the larger companies have adjusted to technology, because in Canada, there were many people that, you know, when you had documents to sign, for example, you had to be in an office or, you know, face to face with a person in order to get those documents signed. Technology has adjusted, and there's companies out there that specialize in e-signatures, which provides a comfort level to these larger companies when they have these confidentiality responsibilities. You know, where companies like Uber may have had to right size for the time being, other companies have been able to expand their workforce because of the technology that they provide.
Yeah, that's a great point. And let's contrast two companies. And I don't own the stock in either one of them, but to me, this is kind of the framework I'm thinking about. DocuSign, whose business has forever has changed, right? In other words, they are become even more dominant in a sense. E-signature got to critical mass where you see its adoption only going to increase. Even if pandemic is over tomorrow, everybody's vaccinated, we're still going to continue to use more e-signature just because it makes so much more sense, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. And then let's think about another company. And I really like, and I'm just really thinking out loud, like a company like Peloton, right? So, and this is like, because that applies, this Peloton framework applies to many other companies. So during the pandemic, a lot of, you know, gyms were closed. So people bought Pelotons. Some people bought Pelotons because they really like to, you know, do those classes online and do, you know, and do those classes, like, and have a bike in their own home. Some people did this because they, you know, they stopped going to gyms and but they still wanted to work out. Now, when the gyms open up, right, the ones that still open up, what's going to happen for the demand, for future demand for Peloton? And this is where, like, I've been thinking about, okay, well, will it snap back and people who are going to gyms will start going to gyms again? Or it changed the behavior and they say, I actually kind of like doing Peloton at home. So, and same applies to many other things, like, you know, how much shopping we used to do in person versus online, how much, you know. So anyway, so I'm kind of asking myself this question. If I'm looking at the business, and am I asking myself, how would the business look after the pandemic? And for some businesses, it's kind of, it accelerated the adoption of this business, and it's only going to get more dominant. Other business may give up some of the dominance. So I don't know. So that's kind of just thinking out loud.
Yeah, you know what? I like your comparison with Peloton, because I've always worked out at home. And so for me, it wasn't a huge change. But, you know, it will be interesting, because I imagine that they're, you know, they've done really well with people adopting their business model, doing the workouts at home with video and everything else. I mean, their commercials are certainly inspiring to that end. Way harder than anything I do, let me put it that way. Wow, this has been fascinating, Vitaly. I can't tell you how much I've enjoyed this conversation. You've given our listeners some really great tips. You know, if they have clients that do want to do their own investing or are looking for companies to do the investing for them, you've given us a lot of food for thought. Would you like to leave our listeners with any final thoughts?
I'm not sure. I think
they already got a lot. There's a lot
I think I just told you everything I know. So it's kind of difficult to do it.
I doubt it's everything. I'm pretty sure there's a whole lot more we can pick your brain for. But and how can people get in contact with you?
Well, I think if they want to read my articles, I would go to contrarianedge.com. Or just if you want to listen to our podcasts, go to investor.fm, like FM radio, investor.fm. And that's basically probably the best way to kind of get to know us. One thing about podcasts, which is something I really appreciate as a listener, you can binge listen to them. So if a lot of times when I find a podcast that I really like, I go back to the very first episode and listen to, you know, try to listen to as many, you know, if I still like it after the, you know, going back, I listen to a lot of episodes. I think, you know, your listeners can probably do the same thing with our podcast too.
Well, and you had a lot of really interesting ones there. Let me tell you, it was tough to pick one to talk about with you today.
Thank you so much for that. I, you know, really appreciate that.
You're very welcome. And thank you again for coming on the show. It's been a lot of fun.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
And for our listeners, once again, I'd like to thank Custom Plan Financial Advisors for sponsoring this program. And we will have all of Vitaly's contact information on the website with this podcast. And I hope you all have a great day.
The views expressed here are those of the participants and not those of Custom Plan Financial Advisors, Inc., its affiliates, or subsidiaries. This is not intended to serve as a complete analysis of every material fact regarding any company, industry, or security. This presentation may contain forward-looking statements. Investors are cautioned not to place undue reliance on such statements, as actual results could vary. This site and podcasts are for general information purposes only and does not constitute investment advice and is not intended as an endorsement of any specific investment product or service. Individual investors should consult with an investment professional about their personal situation. Past performance is not indicative of future results. If you are unsure about what is the best course of action for you in your financial planning, then we suggest you consult a fee-based independent financial advisor or get in touch with us to discuss your individual situation. Our phone number is 604-687-7773.